Welcome back, everyone. Day two of theCUBE live at the Raise Summit here in Paris, France. I'm John Furrier, host of theCUBE. It's been a great 2 days so far. We're kicking off day, got a full lineup of interviews, got all the top leaders coming into our podcast studio here on the show floor. Really is a show about AI leaders, existing leaders of existing companies transitioning to AI and catching that wave, as well as, and a nice surprise, a lot of entrepreneurship, developers, smaller teams, some getting big funding, some not a lot of funding at all, but at the end of the day, we are in a builder culture. Okay, we got Prashanth here, he's the CEO of Stack Overflow, friend of theCUBE, walking by, wanted to grab him in. Great to see you. We're
great
on the boat cruise at the VIP passes.
Yes.
Thanks for coming in.
That was awesome, yeah.
So Stack Overflow, well-known site and community around helping people build, but AI with coding, coding assistance, the cost to do a startup is lower than ever, time to value is super fast. Obviously an impact. You guys, one, are a site where builders go.
Yeah.
AI is now providing those answers. They're providing a lot of content. They're crawling sites. We saw Cloudflare put up the little metering, kind of a toll booth, if you will. Very innovative, I think, but I don't know how I feel yet. I'm not negative against it, but also, what does it mean? But I think it's been a free ride for a while. A lot of these communities are investing in content. It's a double-edged sword. On one hand, it's great.
Yeah.
On the other hand, it's not. Give us a take on your view of what's going on Stack Overflow again.
Yeah.
Well-known in the industry. So what's new with the AI wave for you?
Yeah, no, thank you again, John. It's always a pleasure. Third time participant on theCUBE, so always a pleasure to talk to you. It's been a fascinating time for the past couple of years for us. We've been around since 2008. Been the preeminent place where technologists go to get information about any programming, obviously, topic. And we have this amazing corpus of 50 million questions and answers, which has been now reused over 50 billion times, and now in exponentially, now with the AI, advent of AI. That's the B2C side, and then obviously we have a very large enterprise business, which is a private version of Stack Overflow that's used in the world's largest companies as their private internal knowledge base, and more now as their knowledge intelligence layer, which I'll explain. But what we have noticed with the AI world is that probably the best way for me to explain it is through a data point from our developer survey that we conduct every year. So this year, we noticed that the adoption of AI in the community has gone up to now 80% of our users, but the trust level has dropped from what used to be actually a pretty low number, 40%, down to even a further low number, which is 29%.
Trust on the AI?
Trust on AI outputs, right?
Yep.
And so in a world which is going to be, clearly the direction is let's go automate using AI, and that's the wave we're all catching. There is a need for human-in-the-loop, human-curated experts who provide trustworthy validation and answers to whatever the AI is generating.
Yep.
And so we believe we can play a really key role there by being the world's most vital source for technologists. And the way in which we want to do that is to really cultivate community, which I think is going to be even more important in the age of AI, and through powering learning, because you think about the disruption to jobs for junior developers especially. And then finally, through unlocking growth, both in their careers as well as inside companies through productivity tools like our internal product.
You and I both have had conversations off camera around AI's impact to our businesses. We have a lot of similarities.
Yep.
Not a lot of overlap, but I think similarities in the sense that we have invested in high quality content, developer content, and media content, where there's a mixture of experts and resonant in our data.
Yep.
And then now AI makes that easier, so we're seeing, and I was just on stage making a comment about this here at the event, AI is going to create a series of a wave of tsunami of vanilla content on our side. We're seeing already, it's easier to write a blog post, it's easier to write a marketing copy, it's easier to write bad code than ever before, hence the trust numbers makes a lot of sense.
Yes.
So we're predicting, and I'd love to get your reaction to this if you see the same thing, a flight to quality.
Yes.
And so original, authentic, or in your case, quality code matters.
Yes.
And so I think we're going to see a transition of, wow, it's so easy, but it sucks.
Yes.
Kind of vibe.
Yes.
So vibe coding is a trend, but getting into production operationally on the consumer side. So one, do you see that? And then two, the enterprise is going to have more programming skills. They're going to need to have higher quality because they're now, the brands are on the line.
Yes, 100%. I mean, everything you said is spot on because we notice is both on the public side as well as in the enterprise business. So on the public side, what we've noticed is that our knowledge is so valuable for LLM pre-training and things like RAG and indexing use cases, et cetera. That's why we work with every single AI lab as well as cloud provider. So OpenAI and Google and everybody else that you can imagine in the space now officially license our data, because the data produces something like a 30 to 40% improvement in the accuracy of their answers. So it reduces hallucinations dramatically. If you look at the human eval score, it goes from like approximately 5 to 9. You know, any index, we even have our own index called ProLLM. If you can go to ProLLM.ai, which we did with our process partners, and they rank every single foundational model in the context of coding-related tasks with our data being used or not used, and it shows the rankings relative to the accuracy of coding outputs of those LLMs. So we have proven that the high quality data on our site is extremely high quality data, because the standards have been so high for so long on what qualifies as a canonical answer to a question. Right, and that's been the, you know, while it's kind of somewhat difficult to actually engage on the site sometimes, because if you're a junior developer, it's somewhat a little bit harsh, but the reality is that the-
Yeah, harsh in a good way.
Harsh in a good way. It's like, you know, the school of hard knocks, so to speak. On the enterprise side, what we also notice is that data quality is the long pole in the tent, because people are realizing, okay, if you want to use AI assistants or agents, then you want to make sure it's working off of accurate information. So surprisingly, our Stack Overflow internal product that's used, again, by the world's biggest financial services institutions, tech companies, and so on, the APIs of that product were red hot over the past year. And when we dug into it, they were all being used in AI search use cases, AI assistants, et cetera. Like Uber, as an example, built something called Uber Genie that they are a Stack Overflow internal customer with thousands of questions and answers.
Yeah.
They tap into that and then answer a bunch of Slack questions in their Slack channel, and so they drive tremendous amounts of productivity using that. So quality absolutely matters.
It really is a double-edged sword, because on one hand, you have done the work.
Yeah.
I won't say labeling, but basically labeled.
Yes.
So great training data for the LLMs.
Yes.
Great check there. So I guess is the strategy you have to embrace, you're leaning into the LLMs.
Yeah.
So that makes sense, because they win.
Yeah.
You have more lift on the developer side.
Yeah.
And then are you guys on the enterprise side strategy-wise kind of creating custom approved sets of data? So what's the strategy? Because you don't want to be eaten alive, so to speak, because that's not their intention.
Yes.
Their intention on the consumer side is to provide great answers.
Yes.
You already have them.
Yes.
Okay, so now what's the strategy for you? What's the plan?
Yeah, so on the public platform, it's to create all the additional dimensions where we can be useful to our community members, like I mentioned with the mission and the vision that I explained around community and learning and, you know, unlocking growth. And that we'll do that beyond Q&A. So we've unlocked, for example, human-to-human chat, where you can actually go and engage with the expert on Python on the site or an AI topic.
Yeah.
We've enabled even AI search and discovery through not only everything you get on the public AI ecosystem, but also through all the corpus of information. And if you don't get your answers to your question there, ask your question into the community, either into the chat room or the Q&A place, et cetera. Even enabling things like code challenges, so junior developers can learn about the new stuff so they can get certified as an expert on certain topics. So anyway, that's all on the public side.
Yeah.
And then on the enterprise, it's about creating this real knowledge intelligence layer so that, you know, we can ingest information from other parts of the company, and knowledge is always out of date inside companies. So that's what this product was solving, but now it's on steroids a little bit by bringing it all in, adding things like an MCP server on top, and then plugging it into your AI agents.
Is it, again, back to what I love about your company is that there's so many similarities with theCUBE and SiliconANGLE. And words like mixture of experts is a buzzword that's used in the reasoning side. Domain expertise, these are buzzwords in AI.
Right.
And they're built in. And even better now, human reinforced learning with human feedback. So I think that it's a great example of not being afraid of AI.
Right.
You lean into it because you're the flywheel for human feedback.
Correct.
So that's a superpower.
100%.
So that's a value that's going to open up that wasn't really there before. So one door closes potentially.
Yeah.
Which actually is not a door closing, it's more of a lift actually.
Yes.
And you swing back to value.
That's correct.
Am I getting that right?
100%. All content sites have to rethink their kind of business strategy and, like, you know, what actually makes them special in this new world.
Yeah.
For us, we've leaned into the fact that our trusted experts and ability to really have fantastic human curated knowledge while leveraging the power of AI in service of the human or the technology.
So you're building a trust network.
Exactly right. It's a trust layer. Well said. So that's exactly what we're doing.
Got it. Yeah. Okay, so I have to ask you on the developer side, what are some stats you can share? I mean, obviously, some are saying that the junior developers are going to be the senior developers because they get the superpower of the of the augmentation of expertise.
Yeah.
So how are you guys looking at that sharing? I see chat being a first phase.
Yeah.
What's beyond chat?
Yeah.
Agents, more coding, autonomous coding.
Yes. Yeah, so the experience that we are enabling on the public platform using the human-to-human expertise, but also incorporating AI. So then you have AI and humans engaging directly on the site in a way that's really productive for the junior developer and the expert on the site. And then to be able to ultimately bring them along in their journey, I think is really, really important. But overall, I think for us, we want to make sure that we leverage, again, the power of AI in service of the human.
Got it.
And that's really kind of what we're focused on.
All right, yeah. I'm just curious, because something we were talking about on the boat, licensing content. Is that a new revenue stream for you? Is it something that's powerful? Can you share your thoughts on licensing? We saw the Cloudflare.
Yeah.
You know, we're living in an open web, but yet now we have starting to have metering, but there's never a free lunch. We, you know, there's now new ways to experiment that was once taboo. I mean, it was once taboo to say, whoa.
Yeah.
But now with all that sucking out and distilling,
it's
a feature, not a bug. Is it a bug or a feature? You know, this is the conversations we're having in the tech world.
Yes.
What's a feature, what's a bug? What's your vision on the whole licensing and then that notion of what you want to enable the risk-reward ratio, if you will?
Yeah, so we're part of the Cloudflare announcement. So yes, to answer your earlier question, data licensing is one of our three lines of business that we have. So we have the public platform, which is monetized using data licensing as well as advertising. But advertising is now only about 25% of our company's revenue. So we're not like another content site that may be heavily dependent on advertising.
Yeah, you don't want to get too addicted to that because that's a downward trend.
That's correct. Just generally, web traffic, I think, is a very different ball game these days.
Yeah.
So I think anybody dependent on web traffic solely to monetize, I think, is a very difficult place to be. And then the enterprise business is our SaaS and API usage, as I talked about. So data licensing ads in our enterprise business, those are the three lines of business. Data licensing, we have, as I said, struck recurring revenue licensing agreements with all the big AI players. We're also seeing a lot of demand from those companies as well as other early stage startups that are also here to say, can they provide that reinforcement learning? So for example, they're willing to even ask, pay us for you know, kind of like feedback on the outputs of their AI. Much like some other companies, you know, their whole business is based on that, because we, again, we have an expert network, if you will. And then the kind of the growth of that will be in a whole range of use cases, whether that is AI pre-training, whether that is RAG and indexing, whether that's search use cases, and even, you know, custom slices and dices of data, which people could find. Because again, we have like a really, really deep you know, data set that goes, you know, back 16 years, and the amount of metadata that we have is just tremendous.
Yeah.
And it's useful, by the way, for not only coding related tasks in AI, but non-coding related tasks.
Yeah, I've always loved Stack Overflow. It's been one of the jewels of the internet, and it's almost like the world spins in your direction and you're the treasure trove of data, and it's phenomenal. And I think too, the enterprise business, I think, will go more micro modeling, where they'll start looking for single tenant, custom solutions, really round work stream. If you look at what Augment's doing and some of these great, more production oriented, where they're doing automated pull requests, I think that's going to be a direction I think is going to be compelling for the enterprise. Once they get their crown jewels locked down, with the supercomputing capability, they're going to probably want a need for kind of specialized models, where that's something that, is that on your radar?
Yes, it is. More and more as we think about what, you know, you earlier mentioned, when people are now pushed, this is their third attempt probably trying out an AI experiment after 3 years, and they realize all the long poles in the tent. What does it actually take to actually roll, let's say, into a bank, or push something into production in a bank? Hey, you need this and this and this. One of them is definitely high quality data. So in that context, okay, are you attributing correctly? Is it based on, is it fresh and is it relevant? And in that context, creating that knowledge intelligence layer that I mentioned, while bringing in data sources like our own and others into that, I think is going to be like a real, real unlock. And that's kind of where people are headed.
Prashanth, it's great to have you on. Thanks for swinging by theCUBE. Great to see you again.
Wonderful to see you, John.
Love your business. Stack Overflow, again, the crown jewels on the work that's been done. All the answers are in there and more are coming. Of course, the LLMs are integrating in. It opens up opportunities. I think the lesson here is, you know, don't be afraid of the AI engines out there. They could help you, and I think that's a great example. Of course, more coverage from theCUBE here at the RAISE Summit in Paris. I'm John Furrier, host of theCUBE. Thanks for watching.